Dan?
No, actually, they're a little dry.
We can go.
All right, we're in. A little talking about a little skincare tips between David Ochoa and Brad Nelson. I'll let you know that we didn't quite get the feature matches right. What you'll see on the back tables is Lucas Marr and Matt Sperling, and Jerry Thompson, Marco Santopadre, and even Flock and Conley Woods. But we're already started.
And yes, that is a Niv-Magus Elemental.
Okay.
So Niv-Magus Elemental is a it's a 1/2 creature for one mana, hybrid blue-red, and you can remove an instant or sorcery that you have on the stack and give it 2 +1/+1 counters.
See what you have.
You get an Inquisition of Kozilek. Reveals Apostle's Blessing, Thoughtseize, Mutagenic Growth, and Slaughter Pack. So right now, that card can attack for 9 on turn 2 with that hand.
That's insane.
Right, he can have a 9/10.
So what's what do you think Ochoa is going to take here?
Probably the Apostle's Blessing, which is going to counter one of his removal
I'll
spells.
Take your Thoughtseize.
No, nope, takes Thoughtseize.
Again, Ochoa has the advantage of knowing what's in his hand.
My turn. Yep.
Plotting it out. There's a mountain for Brad Nelson.
Attack.
And you heard him.
Hold priority.
Attack.
Eat. So you're casting that in for 2 life?
Yes. Hold priority. Eat. 13. Slaughter pack, hold priority, eat.
You're watching it, folks.
Sure. Take 7.
Take 7.
How many guards? 1?
1.
It is all in.
7, 13.
Go.
Okay. Nelson drops himself down to 13 life. And David Ochoa down to 13. Now, against John, this has got to be a very tricky matchup, because if you're going all in, you get your one guy killed.
Yep.
You're kind of defenseless.
Liliana of the Vale is not his friend. Trying to decide if he wants to bring Damon down to 2.
On turn 2.
Turn 3.
Turn 3, yeah.
Turn 3.
Right.
As it is, he brings him to 6.
A little math going on. There you see the Niv-Magus Elemental up on your screen.
I don't know if I clarified that, but exile.
Yeah, I have to exile.
What would you keep?
What would you keep, Brad Nelson asks David Ochoa. Obviously, Ochoa didn't want Brad to see what his hand was, which is why he took the Thoughtseize in
right,
the first place.
Of course.
Attack for 7.
Attack for 7.
No block. I'm going to... Good shot. Eat.
Yep. Brings him to 4. Just thinking about that Apostle's Blessing.
Eat.
All right. So you're at 11 from
yes.
casting that.
And you're at 2.
2.
Yep.
Takes Ochoa all the way down to 2. And, well, there's a Liliana off the top for David Ochoa. Drops
one
Marsh Flats.
Swamp Liliana, second guy. One counter, go.
Quickly into one counter, go. Nelson 11, Ochoa at 2.
Well, he's actually at 1 because he broke a fetch
He did
land.
Actually crack the fetch land, right?
Go.
There's not a lot left for... I think Brad is on gutshot or no right now.
Okay.
I believe he's on 3 gutshots for the win.
He's already used 1. Niv-Magus Elemental. Has taken David Ochoa to one.
I mean, he has other creatures in his deck, obviously, but he's going to have trouble keeping them around now.
Ochoa ticks up Liliana one. By discarding another one. And there's Tarmogoyf. Go. Also pulls his card. Hides it from us.
Oh. Nine.
And it's Ponder.
Yeah, it's Gitaxi.
I mean, sorry, Gitaxi Probe. So now he sees Ochoa's hand, which is Tarmogoyf, two Bloodbraid Elves, and Terminate. Another Tarmogoyf off the draw for Ochoa. But no fourth land, so we're not going to see those Bloodbraid Elves.
Plus one.
Everybody discards. It's a Bloodbraid Elf.
He discards Ground Rift.
Right, so we got land.
He's got every Phyrexian mana spell.
Now that's actually, I believe, a replicate spell.
Tech.
Four. Tarmogoyf gets in for four.
Storm spell.
That's it. Yeah. And back up Tarmogoyf. And Brad Nelson scoops him up, and we're going to go to game two. So we saw.
That was scary.
Brad Nelson. Yeah. You heard David Ochoa say there that was scary. Just one damage away from really. And that's not even like a combo deck. It's just pitching cards to.
It's a little combo-y. So, yeah, Ground Rift is R, and it's a sorcery target creature without flying. Can't block this turn. It has Storm. So with a Niv-Magus Elemental, so you saw that hand where. Brad pitched
three or four cards.
Those cards are still played,
and they still
count towards Storm.
Yep.
So now you get another four spells
to be able to take
that you can aim one of them at a creature that could potentially block, or even two of them at a creature that could potentially block, and then eat the rest of them to your Niv-Magus Elemental, and potentially just come out of nowhere and do 20.
On the overhead shot, we saw David Ochoa. reading Niv-Magus Elemental once again.
Yeah, this was a card I was really excited about. I'd been excited about thinking about it in a blue deck with Giga Drowse.
Right.
But this one's pretty sweet. there's also Kiln Fiend in this deck. They are all in, though, on the Niv-Magus Elemental. They have Flamekin Harbinger, so they can go get the Niv-Magus. And then just a ton of this is almost like an infect deck.
Right.
And in fact, they do have Tainted Strike in this deck.
Well, yeah, because, if he had had Tainted Strike there earlier, right. Game would have been over.
Right. That one resolves.
Right. That one doesn't get eaten. All right. What's the sideboard plan for...
Well, talking to Brad yesterday, by the way, Jund is kind of... He was like, this is not my best matchup.
Sure.
And you see there, sacrifice effects. You have the Apostle's Blessing, which I think is an amazing countermeasure to almost anything, right? Except when you have to sacrifice.
Right.
Sacrifice effects, it's not great there. He has more Flamekin Harbingers. He has Inquisitions, which we might see him bring in. What is a Clout of the Dominus? I don't even know what all these cards do.
Well, Brad Nelson is one of the most fertile minds in Magic.
Well, I believe this is actually a Jerry T. A Jerry T. concoction from Star City Games Blue, but I think this is.
Can't wait to try out new modern and booster draft strategies straight from the Pro Tour? Log on to Magic Online and take part in special modern spotlight events, modern two-man gold queues, and return to Ravnica limited tournaments all weekend. For more information, visit mtgonline.com.
I imagine there will be some Niv-Magus Elementals in the modern gold queues, very quickly.
Well, you can build it, play it right now. That's a great feature online. There's the little button there. You can just click to get the deck list and go. So what does Clout of the Dominus do?
It's an aura that as long as the enchanted creature is blue, it gets +1/+1 and has Shroud. And if it's red, it gets +1/+1 and has Haste.
So that's That could.
So
it again, when Nithmagus Elemental just wins out of nowhere.
Yeah, on turn two, you could right. You have a 3/4 haste creature with Shroud that you can. You know.
So how do I mean? We mentioned the Flame Harbinger being able to get the elemental. How aggressively might Brad Nelson Mulligan
I mean, they really described this as an all-in deck, so they're, you know, they're definitely looking for a hand that has a Niv-Mage's Elemental or a Kiln Fiend. But I gotta tell you, Liliana of the Veil is not a friend of this deck if they're not dead.
Right.
I mean,
we're gonna pull Liliana up on the screen for you so you can take a really good look at it. There she is. Yeah, she's a repeatable way to deal with hexproof creatures, and I mean that's there's a lot of great hexproof guys of St. Traft and things like this that you have no other way to get rid of.
Right.
Liliana will do that.
And we just really saw that happen, right? You know, I mean, Brad was set up.
Right.
You know, and he's like, nope, it's dead. It's been a staple in Grand Prix. It's actually been we've seen a lot of it in Modern.
Right.
We've seen it in Jund decks. I think it first showed up in Reed Duke's Jund list from the Magic Online Championships at Worlds. From a flavor perspective, the ultimate ability represents the cruel choice Eliana gave Talia that opened the Hell Vault. Which is exactly why David Ochoa chose it.
Right.
For his deck.
Yeah.
All flavor reasons.
Flavor means everything. So it looks like Brad Nelson is going to mulligan to 6 here as he's shuffling them back up. Again, like we talked about a minute ago. Oh, we talked about a minute ago. Aggressive mulliganing is going to happen. Marco Santopadre has taken game 1 from Jerry Thompson on the back table. We can
presume Jerry's playing the same deck.
If it's the team concoction. Now you're on a team and this deck gets concocted and you're not as.
Brad said Jerry showed him the deck. Huh? And he's like, you're crazy.
Right.
He's like, you are absolutely nuts. And then he played the deck.
Yeah, right.
You know, and he was like, oh, well, I guess you're not that crazy. He played the deck some more. And he's like, oh, I guess I need 4 Niv-Mage's Elementals.
Yeah. Brad looking at his 6 really, really hard. Gotta keep it. Scalding Tarn for him on turn 1. Let's see Ocho drawing Raging Ravine. He's got creature removal in his hand. There's the Raging Ravine. See Terminate as Brad Nelson cracks his Scalding Tarn.
Goes to 17, May 19.
he doesn't care about his life total. There's his Blood Crypt.
Talk about the infamous match with Conley Woods against Petter Brosia at Worlds a couple years ago.
Draws his top card. It's another Blood Crypt.
It doesn't look like he has a...
Gemstone Mine, a blast from the past.
Oh, there's a Kiln Fiend.
There's Kiln Fiend. He's crossing his fingers. Ochoa draws Bloodbraid Elf. Probably not going to see that we're obviously not going to see that for several turns.
So we talked about this yesterday in the preview show. You know, Abrupt Decay, it lies. It is a lie. It says it can't be countered, but I absolutely can counter it with Apostle's Blessing.
You can counter it with a game. It says it can't be countered by spells or abilities.
Sure.
There's Tarmogoyf for David Ochoa. It is currently only a 1-2 because of the one land in Brad Nelson's graveyard. Ships the turn back. A little thought process for Brad Nelson here. He's mapping out how he's going to get there.
He's seeing now, suddenly, he's like, whoa, I didn't know if I would get to untap with this thing. You know, every spell in his hand represents an extra 3 points of damage on the Kiln Fiend until the end of the turn. So, you know, he gets to, you know, slaughter pact a Tarmogoyf and, you know, attack for 4. And, you know, maybe do some other things, too.
All right, he's really mapping out his... He's mapping out his hand as Brian David Marshall does the head lean around the side of the monitor
to try
to see Brad Nelson's hand.
The Slaughter Pact is plus three.
Yep.
The Apostle's Blessing is plus three. The Mutagenic Growth is plus five. And then the four copies of Ground Rift is plus 12.
Yep. So that's plus 19.
Isn't he dead?
Here's the battle.
Oh, you don't cast the copies of a storm spell.
It triggers on being cast.
Yes.
Okay. No.
So you don't get the bonus off of the ground rip in this case. You only get one because you put those copies
on the stack.
You don't
cast
them.
You do not cast them. All right. Tarmogoyf blocks and gets the mutagenic growth. And gets eaten. Plays that second Blood Crypt and passes the turn. Now, certainly if you're a Choa, you have the Terminate in hand. You drop a land and let Brett attack you.
I think he's going to Thought Seize first here, which is going to be a problem for...
Report from Rashad Miller, Matt Sperling, and Lucas Marr on the back tables, tied at one apiece.
That's Grand Prix San Jose champion, Matt Sperling.
Along with Paul Ritzel and David Williams taking down that very, very popular tournament this past weekend.
There goes the Apostle's Blessing. Yep.
17.
Choa cracks the fetch land, cracks the marsh flats, looks at his hand.
I think he's just going to abrupt decay that thing right here now. He's like, I don't want to wait for you to untap and maybe draw another Apostle's Blessing and blow me out.
Brett Nelson has already moved it into the graveyard. And there's the abrupt decay, as predicted by Brian David Marshall.
I mean, it was coming no matter what. and Brad peeled the Apostle's Blessing.
And that's why David Choa is a top-line pro. He sees these things coming. There's another Raging Ravine. Bloodbraid Elf, the opponent having a creature on the board, a little less spicy.
It's pretty spicy.
Well, I mean, if you're in a heavy, but if your deck has got heavy creature removal in it.
Oh, sure.
There's a Verdant Catacombs that Choa is going to crack, drop down to 16.
Hit a Tarmogoyf, hit a Hand Destruction spell, hit a Liliana.
Liliana, yeah.
Plenty of good things to hit still.
There's Forest. He's going to cast something. He's got business in mind already.
Got a
Batterskull.
Yeah.
Inquisition, you.
There's the Inquisition Kozilek.
I'll take your Blessing.
Yeah, the Apostle's Blessing is the card that can really blow out David Choa. So there's the Bloodbraid Elf.
Dark Confidant.
Into Dark Confidant.
Sure, I'll play it.
Sure, I'll play it, says Ocho. 16. And gets in for three. Drops Brad Nelson on to 14.
Oh, no, sorry, 14-13. 14-13.
Yes.
I was just doing my own myself first.
You just have 14. 16, 13?
Yeah.
Yeah. 16 on me, 13 on him.
All right, getting the life totals corrected.
If we don't get Jen in the first two turns, we're not getting him.
A little matchup analysis from Brad Nelson. We've got to kill Jen on turn two.
Well, I mean, it's a deck that just can control creatures time and time again.
Yep.
And there's the handshake. Brad Nelson gives it off to David Ochoa. So Ochoa takes the match two games to zero over Brad Nelson.
I mean, hand destruction was really the story there.
Right. He sees the Apostle's Blessing and gets it out of there so that it can turn around and blow him out. Looks like we are going to go back to one of the other matches. I think Jerry Thompson and Marco Santopadre is the match we're going to go back to.
See if we can get a look at. See if we can get a look at another look at this deck in action. Maybe get a better showing from it.
Mm-hmm.
And then, unless Santopadre is just like every other deck we've seen so far, playing Jund. We've seen a lot of Jund.
We expect to see a fair amount of Jund in this field.
Yeah.
Simply because it's just solid.
It looks like a Niv-Magus Elemental and two Kiln Fiends are down on Jerry's side of the table.
There's a little close-up of Jerry's hand.
And it does look like he's playing Jund.
No blocks.
All right, he's in. We hear Santopadre say, no blocks.
Gutshot you.
Exile. Trigger and then exile. So, double whammy.
Yep.
Slaughter pact this, triggers.
Same deal again with the slaughter pact.
So that's plus 12 on the two Kiln Fiends, plus 4 on the elemental.
Take 5.
And then Gem Charms.
Okay, so what's the lifespan?
I'm at 17, he's 11.
And there it is again, Liliana the Veil.
Liliana
she does not like Niv-Magus Elemental.
She keeps it down. I think where the life total is correctly 17 for Jerry Thompson, 11 for Marco Santopadre.
I'm just saying, maybe if you're going into the two man queues, you might not want to bring this there if you think people are playing
Jund. All right, Conley Woods and even Flock are tied on the back table. They are standing at 1-1.
Yeah, all right.
There's a Banner Skull.
Go ahead.
Banner Skull can put the game just simply
prompt,
out of reach.
Prompted the concession. Jerry only had 2 lands in play. And
that's the match for Marco Santopadre beats Jerry Thompson, 2-0. So we've seen the Niv-Magus Elemental deck fall twice.
Both times to Jund. I mean, maybe we can take a look back and take.
Not mine.
Okay.
Otherwise, I would.
All right, we're gonna, in our effort here, on the Pro Tour coverage team, to bring you as much magic as we possibly can every round. I think we're gonna go to the back table,
which is Conley Woods and Ivan Flock.
Which is Conley Woods and Ivan Flock, who are going into Game 3. They're shuffling up right now. So now we're gonna. We had two heavyweights on table 1 that we saw. Now we're going to move back to 2 more heavyweights back on the back table.
Yeah, I mean, Ivan Flock, you know, he's got over 100 pro points. He's gold from last season.
We saw him on the Slovak Republic national team.
Yep.
World Magic Cup. Those guys did really well.
He's interesting in this top 8. We have 2 players Ivan Flock and Jerry Thompson, who are really considered among the best players in the game, to not have a Pro Tour top 8.
Right.
So, both of these guys looking for their big event. I mean, Jerry's taking a big swing this week with the right. Major stack.
Right. Well, I mean, if these guys had seen the metagame breakdown before coming in.
I think they were hoping. I don't know what it is right now, but I think they were hoping that Jund would be, around or under 20%.
Fair. All right.
Which is still quite a bit.
Yeah. Raging Ravine on turn 1 from Conley Woods.
And it looks like a Serum Visions from the Slovak player.
See, he's got a lot of 1 mana casting.
19.
1 mana cost stuff in his hand.
So it looks like all of Channel Fireball is on the Jund this deck. This is a deck that really comes from the Michael Jacob stream team streaming, where they were streaming their playtesting sessions for this event. And they like it. And looks like the Channel Fireball guys went that way. And then Ivan Flock is playing, looks like he's playing Rug Delver. So this is red, blue, green Delver.
Yep.
So Lightning Bolts, Tarmogoyfs, Delvers, Snapcasters.
Probably.
So, I'm turn two, out. Dark Confidant from Conley Woods. Dark Fetch Land for Even Flock. Conley asks Bolt, and Even says, probably. But first, another Serum Visions.
Probably. If you have to draw it and you said probably, you'd be very mad.
Oh, I'm lucky.
Little bit of
gamesmanship between the two.
It's bottom.
He's going to ship both of them to the bottom, and then he's going to Lightning Bolt.
Yep.
No card advantage for you, sir. No card advantage at all. There we see, once again, we see Liliana. There's Tarmogoyf and an Inquisition in Conley's hand, and we're going to see the Inquisition first.
So that's bottom card is Threads of Disloyalty, I believe.
Okay.
With the glare.
Vidalkin Shackles.
Tarmogoyf, and is that Sleight of Hand? Is that still?
When he gets his hand back off the Conley writing it down, I think we'll get a better look at it.
Yeah, Sleight of Hand. That's the portal artwork.
All right, Conley thinking. He's on the side camera. We've got a pretty good view of Conley's hands. He's got Vert Catacombs, Abrupt Decay, Maelstrom Pulse, Tarmogoyf, and Liliana in hand. So he's gonna plot this play out.
Forced. 18.
Yep.
He gets the Forest off the fetch land, and he's going back in, probably going to drop the Tarmogoyf. And there it is.
He knows Threads of Disloyalty, he can Abrupt Decay that.
Good.
So the versatility of the card.
So now he can Abrupt Decay or Maelstrom Pulse.
Yeah.
He's still, I mean, yeah, he also knows that the Vidalkin Shackles is there. And now Second Island.
Shackles might be a while.
You take it, it's fine.
You can take it, it's fine, he says. Because I'm just going to Maelstrom Pulse it. Ship's turn back.
Saves his Abrupt Decay for when he can show off its uncounterability.
Right. All right, there's Huntmaster of Fells. Freedom Clock. Gets his 2-2 Wolf along with it.
21.
21.
Go.
Goes to 21. All right, so we have instant.
Sorcery, creature.
It's 5-6.
5-6?
Yeah.
5-6, they agree that the Tarmogoyf is. Bashing in. Tarmogoyf bashes in.
Looks like we're going to see a Ravager of the Fells here.
Go.
Transform.
To here.
Sure. So I'm at 16.
Yeah.
Picks Conley for 2.
Now, if I'm not mistaken, the converted mana cost of a Ravager of the Fells is 3 or lower.
Is 3 or lower.
Just checking.
All right, Flock into the tank a little bit, seeing how he's going to play out his turn.
Yes.
He's going to attack first. See, Abrupt Decay, Blood Breed Elf, and Liliana in Conley Wood's hand.
No response.
Goes to the Abrupt Decay.
Yeah, no response from Ivan. Was that what he said?
Snapcaster Mage.
Sure.
Points at the Lightning Bolt. Points at the Tarmogoyf, which has already taken 2 damage.
And now when that removes an instant from before the Abrupt Decay gets there, removes an instant, which lowers it down to a 4-5.
And,
5-6.
It's lethal. Extremely high-level play right there from Even Flock.
that hand.
Zombies would also work, probably. Yeah.
Sleight of hand, and then pass the turn back. And there's Bloodbraid Elf. Into Deathrite Shaman. So the Shaman is good protection against some of the.
Well, it's great. I mean, it's great against Snapcaster Mage, right? You, you know, you like target this. You're like, all right,
remove.
You know, take two. Grim Lava Mancer you.
Yeah. All right, cool. The Wolf Token swings back, drops Conley to 14.
Sure. You're at 18.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Oh. Another Huntmaster that fell. So.
Okay, thank you.
Flock goes up to 18.
Yep.
And gets another wolf.
A lot.
So two Raging Ravines on Conley Woodside. Certainly something that Flock has to pay attention to. And we see in Conley's hand another Deathrite Shaman and the Liliana that he's had for turns. What you play here, Brian?
I'm trying to decide if it's.
I mean, you can cast either and still have mana up to do shaman things.
You have to do something, because you. I mean, like it's kind of like a damned if you do, damned if you don't. But I guess I'd play Liliana.
Cards three,
yeah.
Report from the back table. Matt Sperling has taken his match from Lucas Marr. Thanks to Rashad Miller for that report. Courtesy always important here on the Pro Tour broadcast. He's actually going to play them both still have mana up for.
Empty his hand and make Ivan discard a card.
And he is going to discard Cryptic Command. It's always good when you can make your opponent discard Cryptic Command. So Flock has drawn a second Vedalken Shackles and drops his third island. There's the Shackles.
Yeah.
Take the.
Just the non summoning. Yeah,
the non summoning sick.
Shaman?
Not active one.
Yeah.
Okay. And attack?
Yeah.
And wants to come in.
Yep, it says roar.
Yeah, the wolf. Yeah. The wolves and the Huntmaster all barrel into Liliana. Take care of her. Sure.
I'll gain two.
Yeah, you're at 14.
Yeah.
Conley gains two by removing the Tarmogoyf. Goes back up to 14.
Needs a spell here or his Deathrite Shaman will, you know, die.
Just right. It will die right.
Yeah.
Finally thinking about maybe attacking with the. He's going to read the. He's going to read the flip side of Ravager of the Fells.
Don't know what his card is.
I didn't quite see it when he drew it.
Is he going to just get his ravine in?
It was land, and he's going to get in with the ravine, which gets blocked by his own death ratio.
I'm not sure if I'm targeting it.
Okay. It's going to transform, and Flock is going to think about what he's going to target.
Interesting.
Well, does he think he has enough to go to Wood's Dome here?
Well, it goes to the Dome anyway, right? It's a creature and its controller.
No, just you.
Well.
12.
Because he wants to steal it. There's a mana leak that he drew. Now he's going to take it.
Snapcaster.
Gain two.
Conley's going to remove the Snapcaster and gain two more life. Should go back up to 16.
Right.
Yep. He's going to get dropped down by a bunch on the return attack.
Six again.
Nope.
So Conley Woods at 6, Flock at 18. What's got up his sleeve here, Brian?
Conley?
Yeah.
Nothing.
Yeah, I mean, if he activates the ravine. No, it's too big to get stolen by the
Epic.
Second shackles. So activate.
Blocks.
It's 4-4.
Okay.
Blocks the Ravager. Bolts a wolf.
It's going to get mana leaked.
Which is going to get mana leaked.
Damage. Yep, I go to 1.
So 5 damage for Conley Woods. He goes to 1. Clear away the board of some of the dead creatures. His people. Was that a batter skull? Sure
he's
was.
Just. Oh, there's no black okay. mana from.
Okay. It's a good top deck. Go ahead.
It was a pretty good top deck.
Don't draw an island. No islands.
So Conley root for no island from Evenflock. Who says? So Batterskull might be the turnaround card here. Flock is going to Serum Visions again.
Okay, just, yep.
Let's see what he got.
Looks like he got an island. But it's still going to give... Conley's still going to end up with... Oh, no. He won't end up with any turn here.
Scalding Tarn.
Yeah.
Takes it. And even Flock has taken down Conley Woods 2-1. A lot of magic in that round.
Yeah, I Flock was
dying cost me pretty bad.
Yeah, you hear.
Yeah, you hear Conley say
going cost him.
Yeah, very, very slick play from Flock. You know, realizing maybe that you know that instant was on the stack and that he could.
And it was the only instant in the graveyard.
I mean, you didn't have Snapcaster that I knew about, and you only had one unknown at the time, two unknowns after the draft. Yeah. I don't know.
It was tricky.
Yeah.
I think I would do it the same way.
All right.
Okay, thank you.
Here we are, there back we in the booth. I'm Sheldon Menery. He's Brian David Marshall. Exciting round two action.
Yeah, I mean, we caught a glimpse of the Niv-Mages Elemental mm-hmm. deck and what it could potentially do if the rules of Magic
yes.
were 19 life.
Right.
Fell just a point short in the Brad Nelson match. You know, we saw Jerry just get destroyed by Jund Charm. Apparently, they're the natural predator for that deck.
Is the Jund deck.
We heard Brad Nelson say, if I don't beat you by turn two, which is a terrifying statement anytime someone says that about their deck.
Because they know they can beat you at
turn. If I don't beat you by turn two. What? Yeah, we're definitely going to try to hustle that deck into the deck tech, you know, and get Zach and maybe Jerry talking about it, if at all
right.
possible. You know, ASAP. The deck's very exciting, you know.
And remember, you can go to Magic Online and click the button and get that deck list right now.
Well, I don't know if that deck list is posted just yet.
Just yet.
Yeah. But when it is, soon. You'll be able to just
click it.
Go.
Click it on. All right. That's the end of round two. Pro Tour return to Ravnica 2012. Back to the news desk.
Or we could stay here and talk about how good Simic is.
Right. Well, we could talk about how good Simic is, but it would be a short conversation.
Yeah, let me ask you a question. Did you you sent your wife home, right?
She went home this morning. Yes.
You're not going to say you sent her home. You're going to say she went home this morning.
She went home of her own.
Are we going to see you drafting some Return to Ravnica tonight?
We will probably see me drafting some Return to Ravnica tonight.
A little sour that we haven't gotten to draft with you yet so
yeah.
far. What are you? Have you done any Magic Online drafts?
Not yet.
Okay. I'm looking forward to Marshall and I. We're in a draft around round one.
Uh huh.
So online.
I like the Golgari deck in draft. I watched actually watched Rashad draft a house with it last night. It just seems it's the kind of deck that's up my alley. It's just kind of savage and got guys and got kill your creature stuff and then scavenge stuff back and just beat.
It's a grinding inevitability.
There's just here we're coming, we keep coming until you're dead.
Yeah.
So that's a little more my play style than Azorius is.
Right. Rashad and I did a couple drafts where we were experimenting with drafting in the cut, is what I was calling it. Okay. We drafted an Orzhov deck.
Well, yeah.
We drafted a Simic deck.
Yesterday morning when I came down to the lobby, you guys were doing that. And I saw him also doing it with Tim Willoughby later on, and they had gotten around to the Boros deck, and they were working.
I haven't done the Boros deck yet.
It was like, make a bunch of birds, attack, Dynacharge. All right, we are done with round two action here at Pro Tour Return to Ravnica.
Yes.
2012, I'm Sheldon Mennery, he's Brian David Marshall. Back to the news desk.